Well, for those of you who are checking Grace out or newer to Grace, my name is Scott Barber, and I am blessed to be one of the pastors here at Grace Community Church. And we are starting a new sermon series here at Grace entitled Faith at Work, and I'm excited to go through this with you all. This has been something that, if you will, has been working in my heart for several years, and there can be this tendency of this kind of divide or divorce between what happens here on Sundays and then the rest of our lives, and a disconnection, and wanting to see and affirm that friends, what you all do throughout the rest of the week is meaningful. It's meaningful not just for your sake, but it's meaningful to God. Sometimes we can unintentionally communicate through the church, and as pastors, we can even unintentionally communicate that your work, your 9-to-5 jobs that you get paid for are not as important as what happens here on Sunday mornings. That the work of the Lord is on Sundays, or it happens at the church building. But the work of the Lord is your work done well for His glory, wherever it may be. You know what I'm saying? Your work, whether it's on the line at JBS, whether it's driving truck, whether it's flipping burgers, whether it's nursing or teaching, your work is meaningful to God. Your work is necessary for God's kingdom. Your work is worship. And so I'm excited to walk through this series and unpacking, what does it mean for us to be followers of Jesus at work? What does this look like? And I think there's some things here for us to kind of break down and deconstruct, if you will, as we go through this sermon series, to experience God's joy that He has for us in our work. When we're rightly related to God in our work, there is joy, friends. There's joy, and we can impact our world immensely. Do you believe that? Some of us, it's kind of hard to believe that because our work is kind of this parasite that sucks from us, right? Some of you feel that. My work is not something that is life-giving. It is life-sucking. That's a reality that we experience, and many of us experience. And how can we find joy? How can we see that work is even worship? How do we experience what God intends here? So through this sermon series, I'm hoping for us to break down this kind of divide between Sunday and Monday, of sacred and secular, these splits that have been made in our thinking and in society that are not true, that are not biblical. If you consider the significance of work and work in your life, consider how much time you spend at your job. All right? Just consider that. The majority of your day, for most of us, is spent at work. We spend more time at work than we do with family or with friends and leisure or anything else except for sleeping. Well, some of us, we do more work than sleeping, to be honest about that, right? Some of us work with family, and for some of us, that's working out well. And some of us, it's not working out so well. The pay is not so great. But we spend more time at work than we do anywhere else in our lives. How can we experience the joy that God has for us in that? Beyond just thinking that work is just something I'm doing to pay the bills. It's something I'm doing just to earn a living. Like there's some transaction. I have to do this. It's a necessary evil in life to work. We have to if we want to eat. Could it possibly be that there's more to our work that God has created us for than just putting in our time and just a means to an end? As we go through today's message, my hope is to, as we begin the sermon series, to see that work is good. It's intrinsically good. It's even necessary to be a human being. We need to work. In the healthiest way possible to understand that word need. And it can bring us joy as well. Today's passage, we're going to go all the way to the beginning, because that's where work starts, all the way back at the beginning, in Genesis chapter 1, starting at verse 26. So if you have your Bible or Bible app with you, or Bibles under the chairs, if you don't have a Bible and you want to follow along, go ahead and turn to Genesis chapter 1. We're going to begin at verse 26, and later on we'll progress to chapter 2 as well. But let's dive in here to God's Word, and then we'll pause to pray as we receive it. Genesis 1. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds in the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth." And God said, "Behold, I've given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You have all, you shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth and every bird of the heavens, to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has breath, I've given every green plant for food." And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning on the sixth day. Join me in prayer, friends. Holy Father, we come at this point, Jesus, desperate for you, Lord God. We want our hearts to be fixed on you, Jesus. Lord, we need you, Jesus, in every way, but especially now as we come to your word. Lord, we need you. We're tempted to just take your word and become intellectually more knowledgeable, puffed up, and proud, Lord God, but your word intends to change us, Jesus. And so, Holy Spirit, fill us. Convict us, soften us, Lord, that we may hear you and respond to you and become like you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, I need you to fill me. I come upon me, your steward, your vessel, your broken vessel, Lord Jesus. I feel my brokenness, especially this morning. I don't know why. And I need your filling, that I would speak your truth and keep my eyes on you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. As we come to the book of Genesis, I want to make a few quick remarks here. So Genesis is we have God's revelation of himself and of history that he had given to Moses. Now, he didn't just give Moses history without some kind of context, if you will. Just carte blanche, if you will. He gave Moses this revelation in the context of a season and time when religions had become developed, culture and beliefs had been firmly entrenched, and people had beliefs established about who they are and where they came from and what we are about and why we exist. And so God's revelation of how all things begin and the story of humanity and the story of himself is also intertwined with correcting the lies that had been developed over time. The lies of history, the lies of who we are, and where we came from. And so there are cultural beliefs and religions that are being corrected in Genesis and in Genesis chapter 1. So as we come here, I say that in order to prepare you for some comments I'll be making down the line here. As we come here to this portion of God's creation, the sixth day, it's considered the capstone, the crowning moment of creation where God makes humanity. He makes what he calls image bearers. We have a unique place in creation. God creates everything else, including the animals, and then he creates human beings, and he says, let us make them in our image. Let us make man in our image. This is significant in contrast to the cultures around. He's saying, let us make all of humanity, not just some, because the beliefs were that in other cultures and religions, like in Egypt, for example, that it was only royalty or people in high position that possessed the image of God. And what he's saying here in creation is that all of humanity, all of mankind, bear the image of God. All of man and all of mankind bear the image of God. You don't have to have some kind of special position or title or privilege to be considered an image bearer of God. You know, it is all of humanity. So what does this mean, this phrase, that we are made in God's own image, as it says in 26 and 27 of Genesis 1 here? It means that we have intrinsic dignity. What that word intrinsic means is that there's nothing that can be done to us by other people. It doesn't matter what other people think about us. There's nothing we can do ourselves to diminish the eternal value that we have. You are valuable. You are desired. You were created, every single one of you, intentionally, to bear the image of God, to be a representation of God himself. Not in his fullness, but in his likeness. You have dignity, value, and worth. Nobody can take it from you. Nothing anybody has done to you can take it from you. It doesn't matter what you think about yourself. It cannot change your value and your worth and your dignity. It's intrinsic into who we are as made in the image of God. This is significant because, friends, as we get later here and talk about our work, we get things in the reverse order. Our image is how we understand what follows here in the verbs and the corresponding actions that God gives us. You see, we define ourselves, our tendency is to define ourselves by our relationships and by our work. But that's when we become distorted and destroyed. Your dignity is in that you are created by God and bear his image. Hold on to that truth. And so we see, verse 27, so God created man in his image. He created him, male and female. God blessed them, said, be fruitful, multiply, have dominion over the fish of the sea, fill the earth and subdue it. So we have these corresponding actions that to bear God's image is one, to represent him in this world. To be a representative, but to also represent him as if like David, for example, the sculpture of David by Michelangelo is a representation of the iconic and epic stories of the real man, David. We cannot encapsulate all that is God. But we reflect him in creation here. We do so in relationship. He made us for community. You see that he created them male and female. So we're to live in loving, diverse community with each other. That represents God in this world when we live in loving, diverse community. But then he goes on explaining and expressing that as you fill the earth, you are to subdue it and have dominion over it. Right here we have the expression of work, that part of living out our divine design is that we are to continue God's creative work. You see, in other religions, humanity was an afterthought. Humanity was created to clean up and do the dirty work, to do the labor, because that was below the gods. And so humanity was created. But this is not the case in reality, that God created us to share in his work, to represent him and continuing his creative and stewarding work of his beautiful creation in earth here. And this language of subduing and having dominion over is in our ruling, sharing in God's ruling over creation. God picks this back up in Psalm 8, the author David does. And he says this: "What is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet." This isn't something lower. You see, David talks about this is a glorious thing that God has given us, is our work to share in God's work. Work is good. As human beings, we uniquely bear God's image, possessing dignity and divine purpose. We need to understand this foundational truth as we approach and understand work in this life. It goes on here. In verse 31, God summarizes here as he steps back and he looks upon his creation. He's just created humanity. And he pauses and he says, "This is very good." Every other day in the week, when God created, it was good. You look through every day. But when we get to the sixth day, he looks back and he says, "It's very good." This is that sense of this phrase, this statement of God is a sense of kind of the pride, like, "Oh, yes. Well done." And you know, I can almost see him like brushing off his shoulder, a little bit of healthy godly pride of, "This is very good. Well done. Yes. I like this." In stating that all of creation, everything is very good, he's also implying that our work, that us bearing God's image in working, in ruling and subduing, is very good as well. Our work, when we see this here, is part of paradise. You get that? That work didn't come as a result of sin and the fall. That all of a sudden, oh, it's part of your punishment, now you have to work. Sometimes we feel like that, right? But that's the work of work. Those are the labor pains of sin. We're going to get into that next week. No, work is part of paradise. Do you get that? Work is part of paradise. In fact, friends, in eternity in heaven, we're going to work. It's not something that's going to pass away. When the new heavens and new earth come, we will be stewarding and continuing to work as part of God's creation. It is good. It's part of bearing his image. It's part of us sharing in his joy. When God says, "This is very good," he's taking pleasure in his creation. He's taking pleasure in his work. And in saying that it's very good, he's also implying and inviting us into sharing in his pleasure in work. Do you believe that's possible? That there can be pleasure, there can be joy in your job? There's hope for that. It's true. Part of this today is a shift in our mindset, let alone our hearts, Your job isn't necessarily going to change, but you can change and how you understand your job and how you relate to it by embracing who you are, why you were made, how you were made, and God's view of work here. Why don't we experience the joy of God in work, in our work? There's several things I want to touch on here, and it goes back to what we believe determines our experience. As I mentioned earlier, that one of the other different religions around the Israelites, there were various stories of creation, of six-day creations. It's not exclusive to Israel. There's a consciousness within humanity of God's creative work and how he created. And in one of these stories is that, I mentioned and alluded to this earlier, that the gods created human beings in order to work, do the labor, and to do the work. We've kind of embodied that belief, that work is somehow less than. It's something that is a punishment that we have to do. We believe that work is something we have to do. Not a privilege, not an honor, not a gift from God, not something good. And so we kind of have this mindset, we got to work our ways out of work, right? We want to work to early retirement, right? So we can stop working. We want to win the lottery so we can stop working. We bought into this lie that work is about getting a paycheck, but when we forget that the work itself is intrinsically good and in the most healthy way possible, we need it. We can't be fully human, friends, if we aren't working. We become a distortion of what it means to be a human being when we don't work and when we believe work is somehow a necessary evil. We become corrupted with a sense of entitlement, that we are to be served rather than we are to serve. We are to bless. We can also distort work by believing or making it into something we worship. That we tip into an unhealthy need. Well, I need this to the extent that we attach our identity to our work. That gets it backwards, friends. And we'll get into more of that next week. That our work is healthy. We need it and we need to work. But when it becomes something we worship, when it gets in the way of truly honoring God, and so our priorities in life get jacked up, and we cannot love our family and love others and serve others in it, we need it for our identity, to define who we are, our sense of value. We need to amass wealth and power and control. It's an unhealthy need in our work, and we lose joy. The goodness of work is lost. Work is good. It's part of God's good creation. And it is a way that we can share in his joy. We have to work at letting God help us redefine it as we approach it. Finally here, we bear God's image in our work when we work for God and like God. So where I want to jump to Genesis chapter 2. And I'm going to read just two verses here in chapter 2 for the sake of our time. Genesis 2:5 and 2:15. And 2:5 says, "When no bush of the field was yet in the land, and no small plant of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain in the land, there was no man, and there was no man to put work on the ground." See, Genesis 2 kind of is a double click into God, how God created man and woman, humanity. And skip down to verse 15 with me. "Now God has created man, and the Lord God took the man and put him in the garden to work it, and to keep it. Our experience of the goodness and joy of God in work comes from understanding, first and foremost, our work is for Him. It's in relationship to Him. And also, that joy and goodness is connected with working like Him. All right, so what does that mean here? There's four things I want to point out here that the Scriptures tell us in terms of work and how we work bearing God's image. There's four words here. Going back to chapter 1, we have the words subdue and have dominion over in verse 28. All right? Have dominion over, it means this. It means basically, the basic words of it are to rule. But I like what Old Testament scholar Victor Hamilton says about understanding this word of dominion, that man is created to rule, but this rule is to be compassionate. Not in a domination, dictatorship kind of way. It's a compassionate kind of rule, not exploitative. Even in the Garden of Eden, man would be the Lord of all, but must be the servant of all. Okay, this is key to us understanding how we are to approach our work. That is to be an expression of service to, not a selfish gathering and grasping of, a controlling of. Subdue is another form of expression of rule. In fact, subdue most of the time has a very forceful and even abusive kind of connotation to it. But in context here, it's understanding that the raw materials of creation were there. It was the tapestry for which God had created us as human beings to take these raw materials and produce. And using an effort, if you will, force, as it were, if you will, to take these raw materials and to create and produce for good. For good. There's untapped potential in this blank tapestry of creation that we are to use the image of God in us, the gifts and uniquenesses in all of us to create with. This is further explained in chapter 2 in verse 15 with the words, as man was put in the garden to work it and to keep it. This word for working the ground, another way of defining or translating it is to dress it. It has a sense of serving. Most other places this word is used in terms of serving. Man is placed in the garden in order not to, again, rule it for his own needs, for his own purposes, but to develop it, to cause it to become something more than it is, better. And finally, to keep it, keeping it is in the sense of stewardship, is to take care of it, to guard it, if you will. It has this sense of being conscientious and taking care of creation. So we're not to just extract whatever we can in our work from our work and just drain it to get whatever we need out of it. You know, again, we're tempted to just approach our work in some kind of transaction. I'll put in my time to get what I need. We're not to approach our jobs, whether it's teaching with the kids and on that team, or whether it's nursing, or whether it's managing or owning a business, whether it's at McDonald's, whatever it may be, we're not to approach our work in such a way that we're just trying to get out of it. Get what we can out of it and we're done. We are to approach in a way, all of us, in the sense of how can we care for this work environment? How can we do this work in a way that it improves the workplace, that it blesses others? The work that Adam and Eve were to do in the garden was to bless the garden, to cultivate it, to produce in it. So what does that mean for you as you think about your work, as you approach Monday tomorrow and thinking about the goodness of your job that you have, the gift that it is, and that you are to use your work. Your work is an expression of serving, of bringing order out of chaos, to create for the good of that work environment, of good of others. What does that look like for you in your workspace? And how you approach your tasks tomorrow, your role and your function. It doesn't matter what your job is. It is good. It's necessary. And God cannot be glorified outside of and separate from your work. Work was part of paradise. And it will be part of the eternal paradise. It is a good, good gift from the Lord. And my prayer is as we work through the sermon series and as we go deeper, that we might worship in our work well, that we might experience the joy of God in our work, and that our community, our world here, will be impacted because of it. I'm going to have Dan Hibma come up here at this point. And throughout this sermon series, we're going to have different people from different work sectors sharing about their work. Dan's going to share about how he lives out his work as a farmer for Jesus. We're going to have nurses, teachers, people from all different kinds of work coming to share with us. And so I'm pleased to have Dan join us here. Do you want to stand or sit, or do you have a preference? All right. I'm just going to get out of your way.
Then. Okay. Good morning. And since I'm going to share from the aspect of a farmer, I thought I would dress a little bit like a farmer. On one condition, that you don't tell my wife what coverall I picked out. It is. I did wash it. No, I think I can get it. It's got a lot of miles. It's one I wear every day when I'm working in the shop. Not in the summertime, yeah, but in the this time of year.
You look beautiful.
Oh, thank you. And I got to have a calf. There. That's my uniform. I usually don't wear a cap, but I figured I would go with the... Well, thank you, Pastor Scott, for leading us into work. And I wrote a few random thoughts down about farming. And some of you remember Paul Harvey, well-known radio personality. He said, God looked down from his planned paradise and said, I needed a caretaker. So he made a farmer. Can any of you kids tell me who the first farmer was in the Bible? Go ahead. Adam, good job. We learned that this morning, didn't we? Adam was the first farmer. Well, being raised on a farm like it was, I have to say that God has put farming in my DNA. I look at farming as God's call in my life. It's my passion. So the question is, how does my Christian faith affect my farming? Well, faith, worship, and farming, to me, are all tied together. They're intertwined. They're woven together as one. Creation of this earth and man are all part of God's plan. My aim with God's help is to be the best steward as I can with what God has entrusted me with. And one of the things about being a steward, I love to plant trees. And I hope in the new heaven that I can be a gardener for God. This is in front of our house, and we try to plant, I think there's another picture. We try to plant, that was just the other day. Love trees. We planted thousands of trees in our life, and to beautify the environment and just for the beauty. And we've been environmentalists before. It was a buzzword. We planted a lot of trees when our oldest was born. We were planting trees. The granddaughter was born. We were planting trees. As a Christian, I pray for wisdom and strength for each day and each decision that is made. With the Holy Spirit's help and direction, I can face each day and decision of farming with peace. But God brings a different purpose to my work. My work to me is not work, but enjoyment. And as long as God gives me health, I will keep farming. I often say, why do I want to retire from something that I love doing? I love to work on the farm. And I love working with our son and our grandsons. This was taken the other day. I should have taken one this morning at 6 o'clock when I was doing chores. You couldn't hardly see the building, but we raised hogs. And that was the outside of the building. This is the inside. And this morning they were just as comfortable as could be. It was about like in here. We take care of our animals. It's just much like you have in your house. We use a method of farming called strip till and no till. These are soybeans growing in between the corn rows. We're trying to do a method of farming that will leave the land in better condition than when we got it. For planting corn, we make a narrow strip, and we actually take the waste from our hogs, inject into the ground in a narrow 8-inch strip, and then we turn around and plant corn in that next spring. And we are experiencing with a, there should be a picture. That's our manure strip. That's where the waste of the hogs are injected. We'll plant corn in that this spring. Then there's another picture in our corn that's about ready for harvest. We planted rye and radishes and turnips to improve the soil. And that'll decay and come back next spring as fertilizer. Why? To build up the soil and protect it. Can you kids tell me in the Bible the four types of soil? Okay, I heard rocky. Anybody else? What's the first? There's four types of soil mentioned in the Bible. There's a hard path, and then there's rocky. There's good, and then there's weeds. Yeah, there's four types of soil. And as farmers, we get to deal with all those four types of soils. We plant each spring, totally dependent upon God's help. And I never grow weary in the spring of seeing new life and new life in animals. Because of God's gift and the faith that we shut down the tractor and the planter and the combine in the fall to worship, to gather together with you guys, and to spend time with family. God has always been faithful for honoring him that way. And I realize that my efforts are useless without the blessing of God. He's my friend and my guide and the giver of everything I am and do. I am really blessed to be raised by parents that modeled God's role in their life. And as farmers, their deep faith and reliance on the daily provisions of life through the hard times as well as to the good. But as farmers, we're very emotionally tied with our work and with our animals. There's a danger as farmers of putting our whole value in what we do. I realize that next summer there could be a storm cloud that could come and bring hail and wind and destroy a beautiful looking crop. Or there could be a pen of hogs that get a disease and many of them die. The uncertainty of prices that we receive for our grain and animals. And actually toward the, I just read a report the other day that 2018 data from the Center of Disease Control, the suicide rate for farmers in 17 states is nearly 5 times higher than the general population. I have to get my purpose as a farmer much more than farming, as big as that is in my life. Because when things go wrong, which they do, my purpose is gone, so I need my faith in God. I must realize each and every day that my strength comes from God and God alone. When things are taken away or I raise the absolutely best crop we've ever raised, my value got to come from God. Only God can satisfy. A couple years ago, we raised the best bean crop we had ever raised, ever. And on our combine, we have a yield monitor that reads out the bushels as you go through the field. And I just was blown away. And I told my son, Chad, I says, we don't deserve this. It was just amazing. It was humbling. And there's years that we didn't get much, but God is faithful. But in Ecclesiastics, Solomon was a very wise man, and he had many reflective thoughts. And I'm just going to share a couple of them here. What does man gain from his labor at which he toils under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. And then I realized that it is good and proper for a man to eat and drink and to find satisfaction in his toilsome labor under the sun during the few days of life God has given him. For this is his lot. Moreover, when God gives any man wealth and possessions, enables him to enjoy it, to accept his lot, and be happy in his work, this is a gift from God. He seldom reflects on the days of his life because God keeps him occupied with the gladness of heart. With God, I have everything I need. In a small town 15 miles south of here, there's a cemetery. And in that cemetery is Bonnie's and my grandparents, my parents and Bonnie's parents, many uncles and aunts, and we come from a history of farming. We're all farmers. They gave the best that they could in their lives as farmers, and thank the Lord, most of them were Christians. Someday in God's time, we will as well. And I ask the question, how am I doing with will all who come behind me find me faithful? What's interesting, I want to close with a little, there should be one more picture there. We got this from Vinden. Their kids are going to school in Thailand, and they had a project that asked, when I am 100 years old. Well, wouldn't you know, a 6-year-old grandson thought of grandpa. And they spent 4 months with us before they went. And the first question is, I will probably spend my time. Well, grandpa did do some napping when they were there. And of course, he has to have a 6-year-old. He likes watching videos. And then also when they would eat, we would eat together, grandpa always had to have almonds. So he thought of almonds. But this next one just really chuckled. Here's what I will look like. And he thought of grandpa. I'm going to be a farmer, and I'm going to be wrinkly, and I'm going to have glasses. That was true, Marcus, a true 6-year-old. And then, of course, those of you that know the Crouches, Vinden, he's a Texas fan. That's where he grew up. But on his bucket list, he wants to go to Dallas, Texas. But the one about being wrinkly and with glasses, that just made my heart glad. So thank you.
Thank you, Dan, and thank you, Bonnie, for releasing Dan to share his beautiful coveralls with us. And that's the beauty of our work. It's in the earthiness, the dirtiness of it. There's beauty in that. Our work is good. Work is good, and in it we can give glory to God. And this morning, some of you probably noticed coming in that today is communion. We're celebrating communion today, and communion is that celebration of the work of Jesus Christ to make us right with God, that we didn't earn that. We didn't clean ourselves up to make ourselves right with God. God did that work for us to bring us to himself through Jesus, living the life that you and I couldn't live and to dying the death that we're supposed to die. Jesus didn't come apart from doing work. He was a carpenter. Did you know that? Many of you probably remember that, maybe from younger growing up, or for those of you who study the Bible closely, but Jesus did work himself in addition to his ministry and his work from the Father. It wasn't below him as the Son of God. It was part of him stepping into our world, being fully human in order to restore us back to the image of God through his death and resurrection. And so as we take communion today, we come, maybe that's you're at a place where you need to address just sin in your own life and you need to be reminded of your forgiveness and confess that sin and take hold of the forgiving work of Jesus. But maybe in your work, you need to replace and restore God and Jesus Christ as your source of identity, not your work. Maybe you need to replace Jesus as your source of satisfaction, not your work. Or maybe there's just your work you feel like exploits you and has extracted joy and life from you, and you need to be restored through Jesus Christ. Come to the altar. Come to the table. We're all welcome here. You do not need to be a member here at Grace Community Church to partake in communion, but we do need to be a member of the family of God, where you've received Christ in your place as your sacrifice for your sins. And he's Lord in your life. Come to the table. If you have not received Christ, come now. Come now and surrender and receive him. Let him be Lord of your life. Let him liberate you. As we close out our worship time, we're going to close out with our communion here. And when we do this in the back, this just allows you the freedom to go back and partake in communion as a family when you want, in your own time, in your own way. And so you don't need to rush back. This is to allow you to reflect and deal with your heart before the Lord. And so let me pray as the worship team is going to lead us in a few songs during communion here. Let me pray as we start and prime our hearts here and as we go to the table, as we come to the table. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, God, for the truth of your word, of what work is. We thank you for the stories of Dan, Lord God, of putting flesh on the goodness of work and the worship that can be experienced in work, the joy that we have in your work, even though it's hard, even though it's fraught with all kinds of problems and tensions and struggles. Lord God, we come today, Lord Jesus, and we want to be restored. We want to find our identity in you, oh God. Lord, we want to let down and let go our control. Lord Jesus, we want to experience your joy. We want to be restored through the cross to what it truly means to be human. Thank you, Jesus, for sacrificing your body for us. Thank you for giving your blood to forgive us, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.